themselves, like, if he ever hit me, I'd be so out of here.
Yeah.
You know, and I've certainly felt that way, but it's insidious when it's emotional, you know, and a lot of times you're left thinking it's something you've done or something you said.
Wait a minute, and because they know you have a vulnerable spot, where are they going to hit you? They're going to hit that vulnerable thing that is deep in you, and you don't even know how they know it. What did you say that he knew? But they're aware.
I know.
It's almost animal.
Yeah, it's very atavistic. It is, and you know, it comes from the very old part of the brain, from what I understand. Mm-hmm. I've done one of the ways I healed from it was to do a lot of research about it and talk to many women who've been through it. But it's true that there is like an instinct, a homing instinct, in them, in abusers. It's so hard to comprehend. You know, before it happened to me, I covered a murder trial one time, and it was a man who had killed his wife. And I remember thinking, how is that possible? Like, how is it possible for somebody who once loved someone so much to kill her, to murder her? And, you know, it was a very big education I had sitting through that trial and coming away feeling like there's something other in that person, in that man. Like, there's an X factor that none of us have. And I kind of feel that is true in abusers, too.
I've seen abusive mothers, so it's not just man to woman. It's, I think, in the personality. How long were you in that relationship?
6 years.
Ah.
Too long.
Too long.
But again, that's why I can tell that.
Yeah.
I had awareness earlier, but it took that long to really trust myself and really know that it was him, not me.
What was the last thing that happened that made you walk?
It was actually a book-related event. I was invited to go and speak to a crowd of booksellers, and they were very generous. It was at a resort, and they invited him to come too. And he drove me. We were on the way, and this was toward the end of. I was really knowing that this was bad, and we were on the way, and he got into a bout of road rage, just horrific road rage, and had stopped speaking to me in the car. And I was getting stronger, and I said, this isn't going to work. I have to go and talk, you know, and be on. So there was a train station, and he decided he would get on the train and go back to the city. I kept going to the event. I spoke at the event. I was just a wreck. You know, I felt like my skin had been peeled off. I felt just, my nerve endings were on the outside. And in the middle of my talk, I looked up, and there in the back of the auditorium, he was standing. He had gone home. He'd taken a limo back up there a long way to be there. And then I had to sort of explain to everyone what it, you know, he was sick, now he's feeling better.
Yeah.
And we went up to the room, and for some reason, I had looked up domestic violence sites. I mean, it was the first time I had ever done that. And when I was in the shower, he looked at my computer and saw that, and he lost it. He just said, you think this is domestic violence? I'll show you domestic violence. And it scared me so much that I finally was, that was really the end.
Yeah. Has he tried to ever get back into your life since then?
No, we're completely,
yes,
we're very apart.
Yeah, that's a horror. And yet in the only, I don't want to ruin it for people who read the book, so tell me how far you want them to know what happens.
Well, I'll say that I think that my own experience was, you know, you never wish that on your worst enemy, that kind of relationship, but it taught me so much, and it opened my heart so much to other women who've been through it and who go through it. So I feel that, you know, I'm privileged to be able to write about it and share it. Because that's my experience, I feel that the book is very celebratory and very very positive, ultimately, because I do think that there's, as long as there's awareness and as long as there's patience, I think people can come back together. And I think that women or anybody who's in that kind of relationship has the capacity to reclaim herself, find her own strength, and get away.
Move on, I hope.
And move on. Yeah, absolutely. And then be stronger as a result.
In a way, I've seen, too, that this is why women kill husbands or kill men, mm-hmm. because it's their only way out they're not strong enough to walk there. And as a psychiatrist once explained it, whom I was doing an interview with, it is, you want to see how far you can get in. He wants to see how far he can pull her in. And then when they can't, they meet, and that's where the clash starts, and that's how people get murdered.
I know. It's a shocking fact that it really happens. I mean, it happens all the time.
And some people, in a way, have a faculty of inviting it, of bringing it out in a person who may have that latent.
My feeling is that strong women tend, it's sometimes women who end up being abused are very strong, because I feel like they're good hearts and they feel as if maybe they can help this man and have a lot of fortitude, a lot of ability to withstand what's going on until it's too late. But I think that it's a complicated dynamic.
It is interesting that Claire, when Grit becomes ill, doesn't know how to get in touch with her sister. But because of the internet, she can look up Frederick and get at least an idea of where they are and how to reach her, hoping that if she sends an email that says, your daughter is dying, she is sick, she is in the hospital, we don't know what's going to happen, that it will elicit some sort of a response, and all they get are calls that hang up.
I know, I think that broken families are, there's the biggest heartbreak in the world, and this family is so broken. And that's why Claire and Grit's relationship is so important, because they're able to love each other, but also to acknowledge that this is crazy, that what's going on and the level of rejection that they're both receiving, but particularly Grit, at her time of need, is just, it's beyond belief. And
tell me about Boggs, because I never knew about Boggs. I've heard about, sand that you can fall into, and but I didn't realize that it really was, and that it exists outside of New York City.
Right. Yes, there is a bog on Staten Island in New York City, but the ones that play a larger role in the book are in Denmark and in all through Northern Europe. There are bogs that, peat bogs, that have this environment that can preserve items within them for many, many years. And in fact, in Denmark, I think in two museums, there are mummified remains that were found that are kind of, national icons.
Well, is this what we have outside the museum in Los Angeles, where they have found mummified dinosaur parts?
I think that it is similar. I think maybe the medium of what is trapping these beings are different, but it's the same idea that, that vegetation that rots and, becomes it becomes like a holding cell for these.
The interesting part about Frederick and men who abuse women is that they also abuse their children. It is as if the child is a threat to the marriage or competition. They have to stamp out the child.
Yeah, I mean, Frederick was just so diabolical. He was a character that, the more I wrote about him, the less I could believe. But I know that people like him do exist, and it is true that, I guess it's a narcissistic personality that needs so much attention, so much validation, and to be the center of everything, so that when there is a child, it takes his wife's love or even her attention away from him, even slightly, and that is unacceptable to Frederick.
Yeah. And the effect it has on the child is horrendous.
Yeah. It's true. I mean, it's so sad to see, and to think that that's how we're formed, early on, and those experiences in childhood make such a difference, as to what our strengths will be and how we'll handle things. And
Luann, you have written how many books now?
Little Night is my 30th.
Your 30th. Had you ever attacked the subject in any of the other books?
Yes, I have. I had two books that are Summer's Child and Summer of Roses that are linked, mm-hmm. and they both have some of the subject in them, and also an early novel of mine called Stoneheart.
Was that before the 6 years or after?
Before, actually, yeah. Well, maybe the first two I mentioned were after, but Stoneheart was before.
Oh, so life does imitate art at times.
You can't help use, I think, some of the emotional experience is very, is always going to be there, but I never write about the exact specifics of what.
The artist doesn't, but you take it and you mold it to that armature to make it yours. Yeah, I'd love to thank you. And I must say, when we were talking about the owls, a couple of months ago, I look outside my window on a pool and there are two ducks. Where the two ducks came from, I don't know. It was almost mystical what two ducks were doing in the middle of a pool in California.
Kind of like the most important scene in The Sopranos.
Yeah.
The ducks.
Would you autograph my book?
I'd be honored.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com. You can read our columns from the Beverly Hills Courier. But whatever you do, support your local library. Go in, ask the librarian, what do you recommend? Usually, they will tell you and they will know what you will like, but get a child to get a library card. They will never forget you for the rest of your life. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Luann.
Thank you, Connie.